So good morning everybody, we'll be starting the webinar. Thank you for participating in this webinar. Just to give you a brief overview of the webinar, this is the first webinar which we will be organizing as part of a series. This will be running for about a month's time, and we will be organizing this in various Indian languages. For a duration, each webinar will be for a duration of about 1 hour, and the agenda of such webinars are given here. One is to just give a brief overview of the Caspedia initiative, like what are the objectives, what do we offer, who are the stakeholders involved, and then a small hands-on about how do we manage knowledge in Wikispedia portal, like how can you author content, how can you review, how can you update, how can you translate, etc. And we are also providing you the opportunities whereby you can volunteer with Wikispedia in terms of content digitization, translation, creation, review, outreach, and in case people who are interested in technology development, we are open for collaboration with such people also. So this is a brief overview of the webinar's agenda, and going to the points which we would like to tell you up front before the beginning of the webinar. Participants are requested to mute your mics so that there would not be any disturbance during the process. The scope of the webinar is only to introduce Wikispedia. It's more of an awareness session whereby we talk about the initiative and introduce Wikispedia as a platform for collaborative content creation. Hence, participants are not requested to deliberate or post queries related to anything that is beyond this current scope, like grievances or queries regarding government schemes, etc. One more request is you can reserve your questions for the end of the session, whereby we have an exclusive Q&A session. So please do not interrupt when the presentation is going on. And at the end of the session, we will give sufficient time to respond to your queries. And all the people who are participating in this webinar are entitled to get a participation certificate. The only criteria is they should have been registered for the webinar in the link which you can see. And the second thing is, for example, people who have joined currently, please join with your full name. So what we do is we map the names which have been highlighted in the participant list here during the webinar session to the registration details, and then the certificate is auto-generated. Therefore, you are requested to join with your full name which you actually gave during the time of registration. So these are some points to note. Beyond which, if you have any session, any problems or any issues that you face, you can always contact us at the email ID indj@cdac.in or the WhatsApp number that has been shared as part of your email. So going on to the presentation about Wikispedia. Wikispedia is a collaborative knowledge creation platform which has been created to harness the strengths of community wisdom for societal or public good. So if you look into the relevance or the need for such a platform in today's digital ecosystem, any digital ecosystem consists of three important components. One is the connectivity, which rather improves the access. And second is the capacities, so that people would be familiar, or though connectivity and other things are there, people should be able to have the required capacities to access the content. And third important thing is the content per se. So when it comes to connectivity at the national level, there are several initiatives that are being implemented by various development stakeholders, primarily the government, in terms of the BharatNet optic fiber network, where the last mile connectivity is being ensured up to the village level. Common service centers, which are now being expanded to cover at the rate of one common service center for every three villages. There are a lot of state initiatives trying to establish digital information centers in panchayats. There are various initiatives which are being taken by civil society organizations. So, and as part of CSR initiative, several corporates are also coming ahead in establishing such information centers at the last mile. Beyond that, the amazing mobile phone penetration that is happening in our country with cheaper mobile internet services and other delivery models, not only the internet, but DTH, the cable network, community radio. We have close to about 300 plus community radios operating across the country. And needless to say, the social media penetration that is happening, which also is an important process of connecting people. So with this connectivity thread well established in our country, passing on to capacities, we have the Digital India Initiative of the Ministry of Electronics and IT, which tends to digitize various government services. And other programs like PMG Disha, or the Digital Literacy Mission, whereby every family, at least 1.6 crore population, every family is trying to get access to capacity building to at least one of its members on digital literacy. Programs of other ministries like Panchayati Raj, Ministry of Rural Development and so on, and several e-governance initiatives, and other development stakeholders who are involved in building capacities. So capacities connectivity is moving at a very good front. And now with all these, the most important aspect becomes content. So when it comes to content, especially in a country like India, where multiple Indian languages are in vogue, English content cannot suffice the requirement of development for our country. Hence, Vikaspedia was initiated by the Ministry of Electronics and IT Government of India, and it is implemented by CDAC, a Center for Development of Advanced Computing, the Hyderabad Center. CDAC has got centers across the country, and the Hyderabad Center is actually implementing this initiative. The objectives are largely to leverage ICT in order to provide information services to communities in regional languages. And second, the most important factor is to act as a catalyst for collaboration and knowledge sharing among development stakeholders, because content cannot be generated by single entity. It has to be the collaborative effort of several development stakeholders who are working at the grassroots level for the development of the underserved communities. So we use ICT as a tool and also use ICT to catalyze collaboration and knowledge sharing among various development stakeholders in the country. So this has been the largest, the key objectives. Besides that, what do we offer using ICT as part of Vikaspedia is we have a collaborative knowledge sharing platform, which can be accessed through the URL vikaspedia.in or vikaspedia.gov.in. Any of the URLs can be accessed. And we also take up digital literacy programs like to access and share digital content in Indian languages for various stakeholders. And besides that, we have multimodal outreach to reach out to the citizens. Like we have the platform per se. We have several services which we run for various state and central ministries, mobile apps, and other ICT channels like community radio, offline resources like books, and also we take up campaigns at the grassroots level in collaboration with various development stakeholders. So these are the three things we take up. One is provide a collaborative knowledge sharing platform, Vikaspedia.in. Second, we engage in digital literacy promotion among the first level service providers, primarily to enable them to access and share digital content. And third, we also take up multimedia outreach programs to reach out to the citizens with government schemes and other. So these are the three major activities which we take up as part of Vikaspedia. Now, who are our target clientele? The first important people, of course, the scope of this complete initiative is to serve the underserved communities. So the information, products and services which you find as part of Vikaspedia is largely oriented for the cause of the underserved communities in order to provide them with relevant regional content in Indian languages. And we also target the first level service providers who are the key players in reaching out to the grassroots. It could be teachers, it could be extension workers, it could be the CSE or the telecenter operators, it could be the health workers or even NGO staff. So anybody who is interacting with the grassroots in order to deliver services, and we term them as first level service providers, they are also important clientele for Vikaspedia. So Vikaspedia, as you can see here, is available in all 22 scheduled languages of the country besides English. When you look at the technology features of Vikaspedia, first, it's built on open source tools. Second, it has a responsive web design, meaning no matter on what device you access it, it still can adjust itself so that it can render in a proper logical manner. It is compliant to all major web standards. It supports multiple content forms, not only text, audio, video, such content forms are also being supported in Vikaspedia. It has several user engagement features, like you can comment, you can rate a piece of content that is shared. You can provide feedback on the content topics that are provided. And you can also edit and add content once you are authenticated to do so. It is available in all scheduled Indian languages besides English. And it also widely promotes sharing of content topics through social networks. Each page you can have a share button. You can see a share button through which you can share those topics through social media type of networking. And besides that, the most important thing, since it's supposed to be a content collaboration platform, there are multiple stakeholder roles, and each role has got distinct privileges, which we will be covering in the coming slides. So just to give you an aspect of what is the type of content or the scope of content or information that is available in Vikaspedia, there are six primary domains which are directly related to livelihood sectors. Example, agriculture, education, health, social welfare, energy, and e-governance. Besides that, you can, in English and Hindi portals, we have recently added two more sectors. One is to have an exclusive section on aspirational districts. And we are also building a digital catalog of government schemes, both central and state, which are citizen-centric. So these are the eight various areas whereby content is available in Vikaspedia. Now, of course, among all content, the most visited or most viewed topics when it comes to agriculture, you can see that crop production, animal husbandry, best practices, policies, and fisheries people are more interested in these topics, and they visit Vikaspedia for content related to these topics. When it comes to education, career guidance, children's corner, policies and schemes, child rights, and teacher's corner are the topics of interest among the viewers. Health, it's primarily women and child health, information related to diseases, sanitation and hygiene, and nutrition. Social welfare, it is again primarily government schemes, women and child welfare, financial inclusion, minority and SC welfare. In energy, the basic information about energy, environment, renewable technologies, best practices, and the policies and schemes of various ministries are of use or widely used by the audience. E-governance, a brief about online services that are being offered by various ministries. The CSE operators or the VLE, village level entrepreneurs, are one of the target people who largely visit Vikaspedia portal. Mobile governance, especially now that mobile is gaining importance, the Digital India Initiative and RTI, the Right to Information. So these are some of the topics which are mostly sorted out after by the viewers of Vikaspedia. Coming to the user roles in the portal, we have about five roles. First is the guest user. Guest user is somebody who can just browse through the content with no registration. Second is a registered member, a person who registers himself, giving minimal information like name, email ID, so that once they fill in forms like feedback or comment or suggestion, the name and their email ID is auto carried so that we can respond to such queries or get in contact with these members who have posted those comments. So that's the advantage a registered member gets. Third role is a content contributor who actually can register in a language portal of his choice, of his or her choice, in domains of his or her choice. And once the member role is authenticated for a content contributor, they will be able to add or edit content. Content reviewer, it is an assigned role. You cannot register as a content reviewer, but it, a content contributor who has got good credentials and footprints in the Vikaspedia portal is assigned the role of a content reviewer. And besides that, we have the portal manager and admin. So what is the content management process we follow in Vikaspedia? So this complete process is automated. Here you see a user comes in, and then he or she registers as a content contributor. The account is moderated by the portal administrator. And once the account is moderated, the authenticated content contributor can log in and he can add or edit content in the languages and domains for which he has been authenticated. So once such a process happens, you can see the blue tab here. There are multiple content states. Once a piece of content is edited or added, immediately the content state indicates that it is in review in process. So that it indicates to the users who are seeing it that a review process is to be done for the content that is added. Alternatively, a content contributor can also add and choose to keep the content in a private mode that is not available for the public, but it can be seen only by the content contributor himself, the reviewer, and a higher role of manager. Next comes the content reviewer. So once the content is added, automatically the content reviewer is triggered to or alerted to start reviewing the content. And once the review process is done, the content state changes to open for edit or publish. If it is irrelevant, the content reviewer deletes the page, and every content page that is created has an expiry date set, which is currently 6 months. Once the expiry date is done, automatically the content page goes into an expired mode, whereby it is no longer available for the public. Once the content review process is done, the page again is available for quality checks in terms of web standards, in terms of broken link checker, and also the archival policy. So any content that is open for edit can again go into the process of editing or addition. So this is the complete cycle which we follow for content management, and which is automated in the Vikaspedia platform. Now coming to what user role is given the privileges of user interactive features in the platform, first we look into the role of the interactive features. Now, as I told you, a guest, registered member, a content contributor, and content reviewer. So these are the four roles that are available currently for the public. All the four roles are entitled to rate a page, and they can also view the ratings which have been given by several users for a particular piece of content. They can also comment. As I told you, if you are a registered member, the form is pre-filled, and the comment you have given is tracked so that if required, a reply is or can also be given to you when you are a registered and logged in user. So as a your feedback can also be given by all the users, and when you are logged in, your details are also registered so that it allows us to respond to your feedback or comment. Sharing through social media can also be done by all the stakeholders for which you don't have to be logged in. And registration, for example, a guest is given the privilege of registering as a registered member or a content contributor. A registered member is given the privilege of registering for a higher role, that is the content contributor. Content contributor, as I told you, can be promoted as a content reviewer based on his contributions in the portal or the quality of work he or she does in the platform. So content contributor can be promoted as a content reviewer, and content reviewer is an assigned role, so the public cannot as such register for a content reviewer. So the public has access to guest, user, registered member, and a content contributor. Now coming to content view features, all portal content can be viewed by any of the roles. Like for example, a guest user can view all pages which have the state open for edit or published pages. A registered member is almost equal to the guest user. Only thing is his footprints are tracked so that his areas of interest can notify us of the topics that people are likely to visit. And content contributor can see his own contributions which he has made it as private. And content reviewer can see all the pages, no matter what state the page is in. For example, it can be open for edit, a published page, private, or a expired. So when it comes to comments are made available to the public after the process of moderation. So the guest user can only see those moderated comments, whereas the registered member can see moderated and his or her own comments. Content contributor, the content reviewer can see all comments which are pending for moderation, and they can also play the role of moderator, either to reject, approve, or keep it on hold. Feedback, everybody can post feedback, and only moderated feedback is available to the public. Besides individuals who posted the feedback, they can see their feedback which is posted by them. Social media posts, only moderated posts are available for all the users. When it comes to content management, only the content contributor can edit the portal content or add the portal content in the domains and languages for which he or she is authenticated. Currently, a content contributor can add, can vouch, or can choose any languages of his or her choice and domains. As I told you, there are about six domains. Aspirational districts and digital catalog of schemes are only available for the manager to add content. So these are some statistics of the Wikaspedia's present status in terms of content. There are about 3.5 lakh topics which are available, and multiple pages of content, close to about 9.5 lakh pages of content have been made available in various Indian languages. There are multimedia content made available, multilingual mobile apps to about 250 plus two apps are there. When you go to Play Store, when you see CDAC Hyderabad, all the Wikaspedia apps can be located and downloaded for use by users. We have close to about 140,000 volunteers who have registered for various jobs, and 300 plus agencies, institutions who have contributed content. Of course, there are several online services which we open up for state and line ministries. Currently, we have about 2.5 million hits per day, and about 4.3 million users visit the portal on a monthly basis. Through our various ICT modes, we have reached out to about 2.5 crore citizens across 300 districts and 28 states through various ICT modes in order to promote government schemes and programs. And as part of our capacity building exercises, we have actually reached out to 1.38 lakh first level service providers on digital content access and sharing in Indian languages. Now, this is a status of content. If you see language wise, of course, Marathi and Konkani are the largest, has one of the largest content of Wikispedia. Besides several other languages like English, Hindi, Tamil, Kannada, and so on. If you look at the volunteer base of Wikispedia, language-wise, English stands first, but equally important are languages like Hindi and Marathi. And when it comes to region-wise volunteers, there are a lot of people volunteering from the states like Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh, besides South, which is only about 23%. And now we'll just give you a small a demo about Wikispedia portal. But before that, I'll just quickly switch to the portal. Yeah, so this is the landing page. You can see here that there are all the languages which are indicated. You can either choose the language you want to enter into the portal from the landing page, or at any point of time you can switch languages. You can also do a search using any of the languages here. So that it can directly lead you to the a particular topic if it is available in the respective language portal. Now I am taking English as the case for demonstrating the portal. So as I told you, this is a new framework which we have arrived at, and currently the new framework is floated only for English and Hindi portals. We plan to actually include the language, all other languages, in the coming days. So if you see, you can at any point of time switch between languages by clicking on the respective language shown here. If you want more languages, you can click on it and then choose the language to go into the respective portal. Now these are the six domains which I told you, and the schemes and aspirational districts are new additions that we have taken up. So a statistic which is updated, of course, the hits per month and visitors per month are updated on a monthly basis, whereas these two are updated on a daily basis. So these are the popular topics based on visits by people are here. And the latest topics that are added, news that have been posted, and most commented, most the top rated pages can also be seen. You can click on this respective link to go into the topic, or you can go to see more to actually. And of course, schemes. These are some of the sections whereby some impact stories and the top volunteers who have contributed over a period of time are listed here. So as a guest user, see, I have not logged in. As a guest user, what I'll just show you what is the important thing I can do. So I can visit any type of content which can be seen. There is a menu structure here where you can choose to go by menu structure, or you can search to go for a particular page also. This is the point I'm saying. So this page is open. You can only view it. You can also see the contributor who has actually done this content, if they have edited, what is the last and first edit, and how many times they have edited it. You can suggest because I have not logged in, you can see that it will ask you for your full name and the message you want to give. And once you fill the message, it accepts it, and then it says that your comment is posted and it will be pending for moderation. So it will not be seen to the public unless and until it is being moderated. So you, as part of the content, you can also rate, and you can view the rating. This is the average rating for this page, and actually 26 people have rated this page, and there are 3 comments. So this is and you can for example rate this page, and automatically it accepts and takes the rating and recalculates the rating for a particular page. So if you see now, I'm just a guest user, though the provision of state is there. You can also share on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, LinkedIn. You can also take a printout of this page, which gives you only the particular thing. It removes all the banners and other images so that it becomes easily readable. Now I'll as I told you, you can see the related links here. You can also do a feedback which is available. You can fill up the form, and again it will be pending for moderation once it is available. So regarding registration, if you are already a registered user, you can go into login. If you have to register, there are 2 roles for which you can register as a member role, which is quite simple. You just have to give a full name, email, password, and then confirm it, then register. And here automatically, once you are registered, you are entitled to view the portal as a registered member. No moderation of account is done for a registered member. Whereas for a content contributor, once you register, a slightly detailed here you need to choose the domain and the languages. And once you register and your account is to be moderated before you start accessing the portal with a content contributor privileges. So I'm just logging in with a test registered member to just demonstrate. So you can see that once I'm logged in as a registered user, when I go into a particular page, and I would want to so though the edit page comes, if I click, it will say it will not allow me to register. It will prompt me to register as a contributor. But if you are a guest user, even that opportunity is not given to you. So that is why we encourage people to register at least as a registered member. And when you suggest, it will not ask you for the name because it's a pre-filled form. So you can directly comment, and the page, the comment goes for moderation. And so is the case with feedback also. In case you want to register with an alternate mail, you can also do that so that we can respond to either of the mails. Here you can see your contributions in terms of the, of course, pages and other things will not come, but at least comments and ratings added can be viewed here. You can see your profile, which can be changed at any point of time. And you can also register as a contributor by upgrading yourself. So this is in short about the role of a registered member. Now I am just logging in as a content contributor to give you an idea of what is the role of a content contributor. So because I have been logged in as a content contributor, and I have been actually given the privileges for the domain agriculture, now I can create a new page. So once I create a new page, I can add the title. A summary is required. Keywords, at least minimum of 3 keywords. You can add an image, a video, and content can also be added, just like you are using a Word document. So it is as simple as that. Once you add the page, you can submit it, and then it is still available to the public, but it is made available immediately for review by a reviewer. So you will be prompted to have keywords which are already there. You can either choose that, or you can have your own keywords. So if you want to add an image, click on an image. It will prompt you to choose an image from your existing your local database. And then you upload it to server, it will be shown here. And where you want to embed, you keep the mouse and then click embed. It automatically embeds that image into this page. So is the case for video or a file. So there is also a provision, if you have already added a file and you want to embed the same image or video, you can search for that image and you can also embed. So in this, if you want to embed a YouTube video or something like that, you can insert an image here, which is already there, a link, a media file can also be done. So all the other content editing provisions are exactly similar to a Word file. So this is how to add content. You can also edit an existing content. Editing an existing content, see, since somebody has edited, the page is already in review in process. So once you can edit the topic, all the words are open. You can add whatever is a content and save it. So at any point of time, all your edits which are done will be shown here. Like what is the edit and what is the, when it was edited, when, how many edits were done, what was the last end. So the reviewer will actually have a privilege to see each of the changes which have been done by the content contributor, review it to accept or reject it. So these, this is in short of how you can add content, how you can edit content, how you can interact using various features like comment, feedback, and other things. So if you are given a higher role of a reviewer, I'll just log in as a higher role just for you to have an understanding. So when I am in a higher role, like a reviewer, I will be able to moderate comments, see the user feedbacks. So many privileges are given for a role which is a reviewer or a manager. So once all the moderate comments are displayed for moderation, so I can either approve, edit, or delete it. And all the users who have been registered, we moderate the users, especially the content contributor. We can give them a higher role of a reviewer. We can see the pages which are newly added, modified pages, which are expired, which are on private stage, or which are in the review in process stage. And who did it? So this is also a complete list is also shown for people to take action. So this is a nutshell about the portal. So I would go back. To the volunteering opportunities that are there. In Wikispedia. So as volunteers, there can be people who can contribute to content part, content management, like they can aggregate content and add a new content, digitized content which is available in as a hard copy or book. They can involve as reviewers. They can also take up translation. They can also get into design, like jobs like designing posters, issue specific pamphlets which can be posted in Wikispedia and Wikispedia social network. We can also, there are also provisions to work as social media volunteers, where you can promote Wikispedia through various social media platforms. There can be volunteers who can actually promote through their own institutions. It could be academic research, civil society organizations or corporates through which such programs can be promoted. Wikaspedia can be promoted, you can volunteer for that. And you can also volunteer as experts in order to respond to user queries or comments which are being posted asking for more information. And finally, there are also opportunities to contribute in technology development, whereby, like example, mobile app development or improving the GUI, so on and so forth. So these are some of the opportunities where you can volunteer for Wikaspedia. So when it comes to content aggregation, you can either aggregate or share content in the capacity of an individual or as an institutional partner. Actually, what content aggregation requires to have at least relevant experience or expertise related to the domain and language in which a person would like to contribute content. As I told you earlier, content can be contributed in multiple forms, text or video. The content review process, experts who have experience and the educational or experience in terms of the domain, for example, an agriculture expert can be assigned the role of a reviewer to review the content which has been added in the portal or which has been edited, or in order to update or value add to the existing content. So these type of volunteering jobs can be taken up by the reviewers. When it comes to digitization, the content topics which are available as a book or which are available in a form which is not amenable for a digital platform, they can be digitized to be made available in Wikaspedia portal, multiple Indian languages. Content translation is one opportunity. And as I told you, expert services to respond to user comments or queries which where people ask for more information. We can also volunteer for outreach activities, whereby as part of your regular ongoing programs in your institutions, you can promote Wikaspedia. We can provide you the awareness material like a PPT, videos and other things which can be used. Capacity building of volunteers, you can become master trainers, whereby in your areas, whenever there is a need for us to organize a capacity building program, we can use the volunteer services for facilitating such sessions. In terms of promoting government schemes and policies, you can design posters, issue specific pamphlets so that it can add more value to the content that is being posted in Wikaspedia. Of course, these are some of the technology related volunteering opportunities in terms of GUI, developing interfaces, mobile app development, or even testing and reporting issues. This can also be a great volunteering effort by the people. Now, the question is like, what are the incentives that are available for volunteers? There are both financial and non-financial incentives. Primarily, since this is a massive platform where lakhs of volunteers are enrolled, primarily it is non-financial incentive which is being promoted. Like we offer internships whenever there are opportunities for internship, we pick up from the people who have volunteered for Wikaspedia platform. Certification in terms of when we run specific courses, we give them an opportunity to for free registration and get certification of such courses. And free technology trainings, access to such free technology trainings are also offered for our volunteers who have contributed to the Wikaspedia platform. Of course, acknowledgement and promotion in the platform itself in terms of their names, in terms of widely promoting them during our events is done. And wherever there are possibilities of institutional collaborations, we work on a win-win situation whereby both the Wikaspedia platform and the respective institution who's collaborating can have a win-win solution. In terms of financial, we do not have much to offer in when compared to market rates, especially for people who content translation, who are involved in content translation, digitization, review and aggregation. But some motivational incentives are given to best performers, whereby the benchmark is like they have during a short period added about 15 topics in that case, based on the reviewer's comments, some motivational incentives are given to the people who contribute content. And so is the case for translation also. So translation, the requirement for translation is triggered from CDAC side, from the Wikispedia team side, to the people who have registered as volunteers and who have shown their skills in terms of adding content in the particular language. So we pick up such content contributors and then seek requirements for translation and digitization whenever the need arises at the team level.